So talk about the building of a city. So you were elected. This is your third term. Yeah,
this is my second term. Yeah, 2012. Yeah.
And you came. You were elected. What was your vision? What did you want to do with the city when you came in? What was your goal?
Well, I mean, Miami Gardens is my hometown, and we're a relatively new city. I'm only the second elected mayor. And so it was created in 2003, and there weren't a lot of businesses. There wasn't a lot of development. It's just a lot of single-family homes. And my idea was that if we were going to be something more than a city, if we're going to actually be a community that had a city as a part of it, we had to be able to have development here, to create jobs here, to create opportunities for people to spend time and money here, to be able to do things like take the city employees, take the city as an entity, and transform it as an opportunity for kids who go to our local college, Florida Memorial, and residents to actually get jobs, and not jobs, but careers in public service and public administration here. And so I looked at all of that and as goals, and then I started to actually break down how you get this stuff done. How do you get it done? How do you get businesses to come? People used to tell me all the time, businesses won't come here because Miami Gardens is black. Well, I was like, most of the business people I know, they want to make money. And if you can show them how they can make money, then you can probably recruit businesses. And when it came to recruiting businesses and development, the very first thing I did was look at our land use. So people would say that, you know, businesses wouldn't come here. The land along major commercial corridors wasn't zoned for commerce. It was zoned for residential. It was like saying, hey, we want businesses to come. But realistically, there wasn't a lot of places that businesses could actually legally build without coming before the city council to actually get a variance. And so we did a comprehensive look at our entire land use. Like, where do we want stuff to go? Where do we want development to happen? Major commercial corridors, the expressway, the turnpike. Where do we want density? What type of uses do we want to allow? Where do we want to encourage entertainment? And you do that. You talk to the residents about it. You have a real conversation about how you actually create businesses. Always over-communicate it. And then you start to create the environment that allows businesses to come. And that's the first step. And just that step alone, it was arduous because people didn't understand it. When you say density in African-American communities, people automatically think of, you know, projects. And I would say, no, you can have condominiums, you can have market-rate apartments, you can have density without having low-income housing. Because for our tax base to stabilize, we needed market rate housing. And so those two things are not synonymous. And I still have to have that conversation. Look, I had that conversation with my mom. When they say there's some apartments coming, a condominium's coming, she's like, nah, we don't want that. That's no, okay, hold on. This is fine. First of all, the poor will always be with us. They need some place to stay too. That's the first thing. The second thing is just because it's apartments doesn't mean it's low income. It's market rate apartments that young professionals need to actually move into someplace. You can't be a young teacher or a young county worker or young state worker and make enough money to actually move right into a house. You go from apartments, then you go to a townhouse, then hopefully you go to a single family house. So that's the transition. Build that type of inventory in your system. Create that type of allowance in your system, the type of flexibility in your system. And what you'll see is you'll see your system grow. You'll see your development pick up. And it did.
How long did it take from being sworn in, having the vision, to actually seeing some results?
You know, it took maybe 3 years. And I'm going to say 3 years. I wasn't really paying attention to the time. But I'm going to say 3 years because I ran for re-election at 4 years. And my theme for re-election was promises kept. So I said I was going to do this, and this is what I did. So, but it wasn't. It was getting people. It was painful along the way, because what we don't actually talk about are the ideas that we have as communities that have been passed down from generations that may or may not be accurate, you know, that may or may not necessarily hold actual value for our community. But you have to actually break that. So you got to buck that to actually get people to do something else. And I was blessed to be, you know, the mayor of my hometown. I'm blessed to be the mayor of my hometown.
They know you.
And to have. Yes, exactly. I have the actual community, you know, collateral that, you know, to say, hey, you know what? No. I wouldn't. Look, this is the town of my mom and my son. So I'm trying to do something that makes her proud and something that actually builds something for him to come back to. And so these aren't, I wasn't somebody else coming in from outside saying, oh, yeah, this is it. I'm not going to do this because I play on these parks. I go to church here. I shop here. I party here. These are things that we do here, too. So I'm doing this not for just for you, but I'm doing it for us. And I think that being able to have that conversation and not being afraid to actually have the conversation. A lot of times you have elected leaders who they think their job is to be strictly a representative, to say whatever it is you want them to say. That's not the nature of leadership all the time. Sometimes the nature of leadership is saying things and doing things that have to be done that may not be popular. Because if we only did everything that was popular, a lot of times that would just be wrong. And history has shown us that popular movements sometimes aren't necessarily the best answer. When we start changing land use and we start talking about density and entertainment and commerce and building industrial, why do we need industrial? You need industrial because it taxes at a higher value and they require less services. So and then you can create jobs. So now you have these warehouses, now you have these jobs and these manufacturing, now you have these jobs for these people, they can actually get jobs. And so when you create these jobs, then you make those people come in and do their job fairs in your city first. So it becomes something that you can actually change from a caterpillar into the butterfly. The metamorphosis of this thing gets actually bigger and bigger and bigger every time. Mm. And so but being able and fearless and having those conversations with my colleagues on the city council, but also the community, was probably the first step. And getting past that, it was just getting past that and praying and hoping that this better work, because if they don't, they're going to run me out of town probably. But it worked. So
it did.
We're good.
It did.
Yeah.
So now you're moving on to run for county commissioner, which seems like, and when you said it, I was like, why not the Senate? Why not, why not go up? Is that like, what kind of move is county commissioner after being mayor of Miami Gardens?
Listen, okay, so being mayor of Miami Gardens to me is probably like the best job in the world because I'm the mayor of my hometown. County commissioner is interesting. So people ask me to run for Senate or state representative and all these other things. I'm a local guy right now. So I like doing stuff that I can see the effect of instantly. So you can see what I've done on parks, the buildings that we're building, transforming our public infrastructure. I can see those things. When you're in the county, you have that same type of capacity to actually do things that you can actually see, but you have a lot more resources. And also, I just think that we need to have a broader question, conversation about where we're going as Miami-Dade County. We have an emphasis down here on becoming this extraordinary place for people to visit. We want to have a great airport. We want to have a great seaport. The Miami Beach needs to be great, and how we get people to the beach needs to be great. Listen, we need to concentrate on being a good place to live. There's 2.5-3 million people who live in this county. This is an economic engine for the state. This is the gateway to the Americas and the Caribbean. This needs to be a good place to live. And that's not discounting tourists and how they contribute to our economy. I'm very happy to have them. But we need to also pay attention to stuff like manufacturing and tech and agriculture and textile and international trade. We need to pay attention to the things that actually allow us to build capacity in this county for us to be here, to live here. And so I'm willing to talk about visitors and how they experience us. But what I really want to focus on is residents and how we do it for each other. And that's going to be transit. And that's going to be a whole bunch of different things that don't always excite people and stuff during conversations. But listen, like right now, for instance, I'm the chair of the Miami-Dade County TPO. That's the Transportation Planning Organization. That's the county commissioners and the big city mayors and a couple of community representatives. And we oversee all transportation in the entire county. I'm the first non-county commissioner to serve as chair. And the reason why I pursued it was because if you look at transportation and transit, you look at those corridors, that's a good way to focus on and to have economic development, transit-oriented development, businesses and density built around rail and major and bus rapid transit, allowing people to get out of their cars and get onto mass transit and go to, employment hubs around the county. We need forward-looking like that. We need to stop having the conversations in South Florida about where we're from. I hear it all the time where I'm from Haiti and I'm from Jamaica and I'm from Cuba and I'm from Nicaragua and I'm from Brazil and I'm from Miami and I grew up in the Bajas. Stop talking about where you're from and let's talk about where we are and who we want to become as an entire community.
Mayor Oliver Gilbert III, soon to be County Commissioner Oliver Gilbert III, part of our family. I'm so honored to be a part of yours as well. And thank you for being here today.
No, thank you for having me. And listen, Karen, I'm working on that book. I promise you.
I'm here. You know, I ain't going nowhere. I'm still here.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.